tuning into cable news, but only one news outlet really seems to have an open door to the White House. That could be Breitbart. We're going to talk about the site's growing influence right after this break. Chief strategist. And because of some other new hires, Breitbart immigration reporter and Paul Ryan critic Julia Hahn will join the White House under Bannon, and Breitbart national security editor and Fox News regular Sebastian Gorka will take a role likely at the National Security Council. Breitbart is often criticized as a far right-wing echo chamber, but I think it's important that we understand what's happening on that site. We shouldn't treat it like it's some sort of exotic enterprise. Joining me now to discuss all of this is Joel Pollak, a senior editor at large at Breitbart, who's also the co-author of the new book, How Trump Won, The Inside Story of a Revolution. Joel, great to see you.
Good to be with you.
I understand you're not on the management side of Breitbart, but I wanted to ask you about Breitbart's readership, about its audience. When you're writing for the site, who do you picture as the Breitbart reader? Because I feel like oftentimes Breitbart gets stereotyped and ostracized, and I want to get rid of that. I want to know, who is your audience? Who are you writing for?
Well, I think we're a conservative news site. We also were founded on the principle of citizen journalism, the idea that ordinary Americans have a story to tell that's not being told by the mainstream media. But if you listen to Breitbart News Daily, 5 days a week, 3 hours every morning on Sirius XM, the Patriot Channel 125, it's a caller-driven show, and you get a real sense of the perspectives of our readers and our listeners. They drive the program. They provide a lot of feedback for us live on the air. And these are people with different opinions. They had different opinions about presidential candidates during the primary election. These are people with different opinions about executive orders that have come out in the last week. There's a wide variety of opinion among our readership, and we also know that they hold us accountable. If we don't do our job, if we don't hold the administration accountable to President Trump's promises on the campaign trail, they're going to rebel against us, and they're going to read other websites. So we have a very close relationship with our audience, and I would suggest anyone who's interested listen to the radio show every morning, 6 to 9 a.m. Eastern.
Is it fair to say that you'll be holding Trump accountable from the right? There was an article this week saying that there was no executive order about immigration on day one, as had been promised.
That's right. You picked a great example of holding Trump accountable. We earlier also said that he had broken his first promise when he said he wasn't going to investigate or prosecute Hillary Clinton. That was a big theme on the campaign trail. And so Breitbart has focused on the promises he made on the campaign trail, and much less these other sort of shiny bubble stories that the media has gone for about crowd sizes and whatnot. We have focused on the substantive issues of policy where President Trump is expected to deliver on his promises.
Folks on Twitter are already telling me that I'm normalizing Breitbart by having you on this program. You don't see Breitbart editors on CNN very often. So what I want to know from you is what you learned in your reporting for your book about how Trump won. How much of it was about sowing divisions by attacking the media, by creating an us versus them narrative?
Well, I think that the divisions had already been sown. I mean, keep in mind, this is all happening in the shadow of the Obama presidency, where he barely even had a relationship with the leaders of the opposing party. And there was a constant antagonism. Well, Obama ran for re-election not just on a negative campaign, but on a very divisive campaign, what people call the class war. So the divisions were already there. And then the media covered Trump in a particular way that sought to exacerbate those opinions in some cases. I think that certainly describing him early on as a kind of Nazi leader, which some outlets did, not just blogs and left-wing sites, but some mainstream network sites, some of the alphabet sites did that as well, some of the major networks. And that just reinforced the relationship Trump had with his supporters. And so, you know, being on the traveling press corps was sort of like playing the Washington Generals against the Harlem Globetrotters at each of these speeches, because there was such a distrust between the media and their audience that Trump could reinforce his relationship with voters by pointing out that the media had given them bad information or simply by mocking the media. Of course, at other times, certainly with individual journalists, he was able to develop a rapport, and he at times praises journalists. He praised the New York Times last week. I mean, he does things to reward people when he feels that they've been fair, and not just laudatory. Sometimes he will even say a fair story is one that's critical of him. He's done that on several occasions as well.
What does it mean now going forward for him to call the media the opposition party? Presumably is not including Breitbart in that category, but when he says that in response to an interviewer, what does it mean for this relationship going forward?
Well, I think there are some journalists who revel in being the opposition party. I think it gives them relevance, and I think they like it. I don't think it's the appropriate role necessarily for the media, although the media will always theoretically at least, be independent of the government, and so they'll oppose in that passive way any government simply by producing truth and producing facts. But I think there are journalists who declared in advance on the campaign trail that they were proud to be the opposing party. I mean, there was lots of discussion about how journalists had to drop the mask of objectivity and had to participate. It was their civic duty to stand up against this man. That's just continued, and I think that's a big mistake the media are making, because there's lots of talk, you know, and I watched the earlier part of your show, lots of talk about the president versus the press. I hear very few journalists talking about their relationship with the public. What's the relationship of journalists to the reading or viewing audience? Are they reestablishing their trust with the people whom they're supposed to serve? At Breitbart, we have a very close and daily feedback between our audience and the journalists who work on the site. I'm not sure that exists in other parts of the media, and that's something I think people could learn from us as well. You have to be independent, but part of doing your job is also dealing with your audience and making sure you're providing them the information they need.
If we're telling the truth, if we're citing statistics about crime, for example, and there's an alternative reality on a site like Breitbart that presents a much scarier doomsday version of crime, how are we supposed to reestablish our trust with our audience if they're getting fed misinformation elsewhere?
I really don't know what you're referring to. I do remember CNN editing George Zimmerman's 911 call in 2012.
About you're talking about NBC's Today Show, not CNN.
It was NBC. You're correct about the editing. That's correct. CNN did, however, say that they heard a racial epithet on the call. So there was some.
So you're going to take an example from years ago. You're going to take it from several years ago. Reach out there, pull it out, and say, "Oh, screw the rest of the media," right?
Well, I have a concrete example. If you can give me a concrete example from Breitbart, has CNN ever apologized for that? I mean, that was a very divisive thing that it did. It stoked racial tensions. It created some of the divisions you're talking about.
But here's an example from Breitbart that people always point to the black crime section of the site. There's stories tagged black crime. Those are oftentimes cited. And when Bannon was hired at the White House, that was cited as an example of divisive coverage, of racially tinged coverage of Breitbart.
There is no black crime section of the website, and I think that is something that has been completely overblown by critics of Breitbart who don't read Breitbart and don't understand what we do, that we there's probably more diversity in the Breitbart, there's probably more diversity among Breitbart journalists and editors than there was in the entire traveling press corps that was covering the president. So I reject that assertion categorically.
By the way, I think that's an important point. I don't know if that's exactly true. It's very hard to measure. But certainly we need ideological diversity in all of these newsrooms. So I'm with you on that.
Well,
is
I'm not
that true
just
for
talking
Breitbart
about
too?
Ideological.
Are you seeing the site going more mainstream?
I'm not just talking about ideological diversity. I mean, we have diversity of every kind. And I think also it's very important, you know, what the White House said this week about media needing to listen is pretty much what you said the Sunday after the election, Brian. You said in a very moving segment on this show, you said the media needs to do some soul searching. Yeah. And yet that afternoon you were calling us a white nationalist website, which I thought was not only unfair but also defamatory. I mean, I think that you need to take a step back. I think the media collectively need to look at what it relationship is with the public, and is it providing the right information for people to make their own decisions? I think you enjoy an opposition role. I think that, you know, I watch your show, I read your Twitter feed, you enjoy that opposition role, you clearly have an opinion, and more power to you. But I think that what readers want, whether it's from your show or from our website, is simply information that allows them to make their own decisions. I think you provide that when you cover the media, we provide that when we cover the news, and people have a wide variety of media outlets to choose from. I don't think there's any danger to press freedom. As the Reuters editor-in-chief said just now on your show, I think it's a very exciting time, perhaps the best time ever to be a journalist, and I think people should enjoy the opportunity.
Agreement from our panel and with you on that, that this is an exciting time to be a journalist. Joel, thank you for being here this morning. Best of luck with
the book.
Thank you. Up next here, the power of information, and I would argue misinformation in the immigration ban debate. We'll be right back.